In this short video, we'll compare one of the most popular Rust frameworks. I'll deploy all three applications to Kubernetes, and we'll use Prometheus and Grafana to monitor them. We'll measure CPU usage of each application relative to the limit set in Kubernetes deployment. Memory usage will also be measured relative to its limit. We'll also measure how many requests each application can process, as well as, most importantly, the client-side latency, how long it takes to process each request. We'll use P99 percentile for this measurement. I explain how percentiles work in this video. We'll also measure availability of each application, which is a number of successful requests divided by the total requests, then multiplied by 100. Finally, since we're running these applications in Kubernetes, we need to measure CPU throttling as well. I have created a production-ready EKS cluster in AWS to run each test. If you're interested, I have a full course on my channel on how to create one. I'm using new M7A 8 extra large instances. The applications I'm testing only get a subset of available CPU and memory, while the rest is reserved for other infrastructure and clients generating load. Each application has /API/devices endpoint that returns the data to the client in JSON format. You can find the source code in my public GitHub repo. If you think anything can be improved, any tips or pull requests are always welcome. If the changes make a difference, I will update the video with the new results. Each application also includes standard Rust optimizations for the release profile, and all of them are built with a release flag, and I use distroless Debian image to create the Docker images. Here are the final image sizes. We could reduce them even further by using UPX, as I did with Go images, bringing them down to 3 or 4 megabytes. However, for this test, the size doesn't really matter. Alright, let's deploy all three applications to Kubernetes and maybe run them for 15 minutes in idle state. You can see a slight difference in CPU usage between frameworks, but it's really, really small and doesn't mean much at this point. On the other hand, memory usage is also very small, but you may notice a different behavior. Axum shows a flat memory usage, while Actix and Rocket have some spikes. Now let's start the test and deploy Kubernetes jobs to generate the load. The entire test took about 1.5 hours. But I have reduced it to just a few minutes for this video, and at the end we'll go through each graph for the entire test duration. We're going to gradually increase the number of virtual clients every 3 minutes by 1000 requests per second, and continue until these applications start to fail. At the start of the test, with a small load, the most important metric is client latency. You can see that the Rocket framework, even at the beginning, has the highest latency, and its CPU usage is also higher than other frameworks. However, memory usage remains steady for the entire duration, because Rust doesn't have garbage collection and we're not using much memory, we're just returning hard-coded values in JSON format. At this point, Actix and Axum have similar CPU and latency performance. This is around 20% of the maximum load these applications can handle, so we can conclude that under low load, Actix and Axum behave almost the same. However, in real-world testing, we would want to explore all possible scenarios, including pushing each application to its breaking point. I should mention that I ran this test multiple times on different EC2 instances to ensure there were no noisy neighbors and the results were consistent. Now, let's continue running the test for a few more minutes. At about 30% of the total requests each application can handle, we start to see differences. At the 30%, which I would still consider a light load, Actix has the lowest latency, followed by Axum, with Rocket being the slowest. As we increase the load, the difference between Actix and Axum becomes more noticeable, not just in latency, but also in CPU usage. although the difference is small, it's still apparent. At this point, the average request takes about 100 to 200 microseconds, not milliseconds. I set the client timeout for this test to 200 milliseconds. So when client requests start to timeout, they receive 4 or 8 status codes, which affects availability. To push application to its breaking point in Kubernetes, it's not necessary to reach 100% CPU or memory usage. Applications can become slow and unresponsive, leading to client timeouts. Kubernetes health checks, specifically readiness probes, can also time out, and application can be removed from the service pool. For this test, failure means availability drops, and application can no longer handle requests within a reasonable time, in this case 200 milliseconds. Alright, let's push it to the end. By the way, I also have a playlist on my channel with different benchmarks that you might find interesting. At around 27,000 requests per second, applications start to fail. So I would say the maximum sustainable load is about 26,000 requests per second before the response time degrades significantly and the application should be removed from the pool. Even if the latency varies between the three applications, they all start failing around at the same time. Still, at this point, Actix had the lowest latency among all the three frameworks. Now, let me show you the graphs for the entire test duration. First, we have requests per second graph. Next, memory usage. You can see spike in memory usage when applications started slowing down and had to store more pending requests. Then we have CPU usage graph. As you can see, Rocket uses the most CPU and Actix uses less CPU than Rocket and Axum. Next is availability graph. Although all applications started failing around the same time, we can see from the graph that Actix had higher availability, meaning it served more requests with lower latency. Next time, I'll try reducing the load increments to see which one can handle more requests. Finally, we have client latency graph. Toward the end of the test, we see some spikes, but those are not the most important part of the test. Let's focus only on the time when the applications were healthy. From this graph, we can see Actix had the lowest latency and was the last to fail. Also, there was no CPU throttling because none of the applications reached 100% or even close. If you think you can improve Rust code, any pull requests are welcome. Also, let me know what should I test next. Maybe some programming frameworks or open source projects. Thank you for watching and I'll see you in the next video.